Today is May 8th, 2021. My name is Anne Shi. I'm working for the Houston Asian American Archive, and we're here to interview Dora Wong. How are you, Dora?
I'm fine, thank you.
Great. It's such an honor to be interviewing you. To start with our history interview, can you tell us when and where were you born?
I was born in the 30s in Shanghai, China.
That's wonderful. Can you share with us some of the childhood memories back in Shanghai?
Well, I attend to the Sacred Heart school and actually learned by the American and European priest and nun, all my teachers, nun and priest. It's mm-hmm. Catholic school. And every child has to be Catholic in order to go to the school. So my family actually is Buddhist. My father and mother believe in Buddha. But because I have to study in the school, so I become a Catholic. Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Mm-hmm. I finished high school, Aurora High School, the same school there. The high school called Aurora, and then after I finished Aurora High School, I went to the Fudan University mm-hmm. to study, and which is also in Shanghai, but in the suburb of Shanghai. And I studied finance, international trade. At that time, I was very lucky to get into this college because it's run by Communist Party in 1949, and after 1949, Communist Party came, so the school, we don't have to pay any money, but we have to live in the school, very far away. And most, 90% the student is men, is boys in other words. But I was very lucky as a woman can get into the school. But meantime, I feel like I'm very, what do I say? All the boys like to help me, because very few girls in the whole school. So I feel very happy that way. Everybody trying to help me and pay attention to me. Even the college professor, assistant professor, they are nice to me.
Such fondly memories.
Yes.
Can you share with us what your parents were doing back then?
My father actually, when he was young, he's a lawyer, and in China, in Shanghai, and he has a lot of good clients, mm-hmm. and they all very very big businessmen, very important, very powerful politician in Shanghai at that time, and so afterwards after he didn't want to be a lawyer. He want to be a manufacturer like a factory, and then he doesn't have enough money himself, so because he knows all those famous rich people, and he's the founder of the paper mills, in Jiaxing, the first one they make the paper mill in Jiaxing, big factory, and produce paper, the paper for the stationery, the paper for cigarettes paper, and. Every kind of purpose for the paper, and so he has his clients to invest money in him. So he's not only the shareholder; he's the founder, also the shareholder. But he doesn't have enough money. But all his clients help him to make a big investment. So after one factory, they become three factory. Mm-hmm. One is Jiaxing, one is Hangzhou, and another one in Yunnan, Kunming. Mm-hmm. So three big factory. They're still there, not owned by the government.
And how many siblings do you have?
How many what?
Siblings, like sisters and brothers.
Oh, I have a half a sister, which my father lost the first wife. Then he became a widow, and he married to my mother. My mother's much younger than him. Mm-hmm. So when I was born, he's already retired. Mm-hmm. He's already 50 years old, And my half sister's like my mother. And he's she's like at least 16 years older than I am, And I grew up with my father and my half sister because my mother and father really do not get along, because they have such an age difference. So usually I just study under my sister's teach me all the things because she's very very bright, she's a very clever woman, very bright. So she teach me everything I don't understand in the school. So I always get number one in school, but I'm actually lazy one. I don't go to library to study. I don't do a lot of things. But my sister is very brilliant student, mm-hmm. and she teaches me everything, so I can get very good points in the school.
Oh, that's
wonderful. Yeah. So I grew up with my half-sister. Mm-hmm. And I have another younger brother and younger sister, but I don't see them when I was young because they live with my mother in my grandmother's home. Mm-hmm. Because they're separate for a long time, my father and mother.
Can you tell us about your Chinese name?
Wang Huiyi.
And is there any metaphor behind the name? Any kind of meaning?
Well, it's just Huiyi means a flower in the winter. Mm-hmm. That means I have to be very strong, that's all. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And also you were kind of experienced the Cultural Revolution. Can you tell us?
Like, no, I don't experience anything. I already went to Hong Kong. After I finished for that university, I went to Hong Kong. So I don't know about cultural. I don't know anything about it. At that time, I was in China, although Communist Party, you know, controlled the whole country, right? But they was very nice to me, you know. And I don't know anything about any difficulties, no. Not me.
And have your family experienced anything?
No, my father always loved China, and he actually very support Communist Party. He automatically give the factory to the Communist Party, mm-hmm. you know. So they never punish him or anything like that. No. He's very. My father loved China and he cooperated with Communist Party and he support them.
And can you tell us why you chose to move to Hong Kong? Because it must be.
The thing is, the trouble is when I finished Fudan University, the government wants to send me to very far to work, like Dongbei. Mm-hmm. I don't know how to say the, you know, Dongbei. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yes. And it's very cold over there. Mm-hmm. I don't want to go there. So then I try to leave China. I don't want to get a job from government because then I feel whatever they want me to do, maybe I don't want to do, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's what I think, maybe I go to Hong Kong. Hong Kong's, besides, I'm always afraid cold weather, my body. So I want to go to some warm place, you know. And I don't like this job, so I go to Hong Kong. Mm-hmm.
So in your upbringing, what were some of the defining moments in your life or kind of what exposure to arts and fashion did you have in your earlier life?
No. I always like beautiful things because I don't like sports. So I don't play like other children, they play sports. So I like to buy little beautiful things, little beautiful picture to look at a long time. That's what developed that I like art. And fashion, I don't know anything. When I was young, I don't know anything about fashion. But I like beautiful things always.
What neighborhood in Shanghai were you growing
up? My father has a house in the French section. Mm-hmm. In the French section, they have, you know, in the old days they have French section, they have a German section, you know, in Shanghai. I live in the French section, and near my school, not too far from school.
Mm-hmm. And what were some of the childhood games that you remember playing?
What game?
Yeah, like do you kind of have card games?
No, I never like card. I don't like that. I like to look at movies.
Oh, movies?
Yeah, international movie. I'm crazy about Ella Frame, you know, Terrence Power, all those movie stars. Vivi Lee, you know.
Oh, wow.
In the 1930s, those movies. Yeah. No, I don't play games. Mm-hmm. I don't like gambling or anything, play any game. I don't have girlfriends, only classmates, mm-hmm. you know, because my father liked to me stay home, you know, with him. You know. He retired, so he needs me to be companionship. Mm-hmm. He don't allow me to play outside with any other children.
What was the relationship like between you and your father? Like
very close, mm-hmm. very close. He teach me everything about what I have to do. You know, he tell me I have to study hard, I have to work hard, become independent. Don't rely on anybody. You know, like that.
And did you aspire to become a fashion designer?
No, not at all. I never dreamed to be a fashion designer. Mm-hmm. No.
What was the moment that made that you made that decision?
No, because when I went to Hong Kong, I need a job. Mm-hmm. So I worked because I studied international trade. You know? So somebody want a secretary, mm-hmm. in the publishing company. I need a secretary, and so I applied a job, and they hired me. But I don't know how to do the secretary job because you have to know shorthand, you have to know how to typing, I don't know all those things, but they hire me anyhow. So I feel very embarrassing. I cannot continue to do the job because I really don't know how. You know, in China, we never learn shorthand typing those things. We don't. So I don't know how. And the manager said, "What more can I do for you?" He says, and I said, "Well, I can learn." He says, "You cannot learn. I want a secretary right away to help me." You know, so then afterwards I quit this job because I cannot continue to work for him. And somebody introduced me to a fashion designer. He's French. She's French, and she's a very good designer. She has a boutique salon in the Repulse Bay Hotel in Hong Kong, and she needs assistant. She needs assistant to translation her English to the Chinese worker. The Chinese worker do not understand English. And she, her English is also very bad. She mainly speak French. But I understand French a little bit, and my English is okay, so I can be assistant to her. But I don't know anything about fashion. So I learned something from her. That's what it is. But she don't need me to be assistant for her fashion. She needs me to translation all her ideas to the tailor, to the workers. Because they don't understand what she talk about. That's what that, my job.
Although she didn't kind of teach you how to do things, would you call her like the person who kind of led your way into the door of fashion?
No. She needs me as a translation, you know. But then sometimes she says, "Do you think this evening gown is beautiful?" I say, "Yes, it's beautiful." I say, "Why you need five linings?" You know, because she makes always very expensive couture fashion. Not ordinary people wear. Mostly celebrities. A lot of movie stars are her client. You know? And he says, "Yeah, that's what the high fashion needs, four or five linings." Then she said, "How can you so stupid? You don't understand that." And she has a very bad temper. I always say I'm stupid because I don't know. I ask a stupid question. And then after 1 year, I worked for her. She retired. She doesn't want to work anymore. And she wanted to go back to Paris. And then I said, then I lost my job, right? And she says, "Oh, it doesn't matter. You wanted to learn, I can put you to school in Paris. And you can learn more, you can be in your own business, you know." I said, "Well, that would be nice." So she put me in the very, very high fashion school in Paris, Balenciaga, very big one. And because of her help, I get into the school. And I study everything about fashion. Before, I don't know anything. But I like it. I like beautiful dresses, all those things. You know. I like to wear beautiful things, but I don't know anything about fashion. So I learned, and then I didn't finish the whole course because it takes a few years to finish the course. And I don't like to live in Paris. You know, I just feel lonesome over there. So that's what I went to Hong Kong, back to Hong Kong, and started my own business. That's the whole story.
Wow. How was France for you? Was France difficult for you to kind of transition into the language, the lifestyle?
No, I know French word. Mm-hmm. When I was in high school, we studied French. I can understand what they talk, but I don't talk really very good, very mm-hmm. good French. But I understand what they talk French. I understand what they talk. Mm-hmm.
But kind of when you were in Shanghai and Hong Kong and France, was the first point of kind of European concept for you? The kind of lifestyle in France, like its fashion styles and like lifestyles, and did it impact you in terms of how you make clothing and fashion designs later on?
Well, I have to because I cannot work in office. I'm not qualified to work as office. So I need a job, and I think it's very interesting fashion, you know. After I learn, I think it's very interesting, and I can do it, you know. Some job I cannot do it. This job I can do it. Of course, I'm not the number one famous designer, you know, but I know the whole idea, you know, how to make a beautiful clothes, and how you socially understand, you know, what the woman, how they wear those clothes, you know, the way it is, I know. So in Hong Kong, we have advantage. We have a lot of good tailors. They handmade everything good, you know. So I started my own line called Pandora, and first started mail order business. Because I don't have money to open the big salon. So the mail order, she gave me the list of her customers. So I started mail order business. I saved some money from the mail order business. Then I started my own salon, you know, mm-hmm. own the fashion salon. The first time is in Kowloon side, called Ambassador Hotel, in the Ambassador Hotel. And then afterwards, 2 years later, I went to Hong Kong Hilton Hotel. also become my own business and my own fashion salon. And then later on, I do export business. Then I start a big factory. Everything I design, I make, I export to America, to London, and even to Greece, you know, to a lot of different countries, export to them.
Can you tell us how the name Pandora came from?
Oh, that's a friend of mine, and actually he's American. He thinks my name is called Dora, and he says you use Pandora name. He gave me the name.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think it's cute because my name is Dora, so he says Pandora. Like that.
And then we also learned of the history of Pandora, and that connects with the current jewelry designer Pandora. So, like, can you tell us that story?
No. In my fashion salon, I have a little jewelry, not too much jewelry, a little bit. Because some people will say, oh, I wear this beautiful evening gown, what am I wear evening? You know, would I wear earring with it? So I have a little bit jewelry, not expensive jewelry, like fashion jewelry.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't know, after I closed my store, I think these people want to use my name as their jewelry line, and I don't know. I didn't sell to them. I don't sell my name to them. You know. But Pandora in Hong Kong is very, very, very famous afterwards. You know. So people like the name probably. I don't know. But I'm not mainly in the jewelry business. I'm mainly in the fashion business. I have little jewelry on the side, you know, when people want to wear something, you know, just fashion jewelry, not expensive jewelry.
And to learn more about the stories as you were coming into the main fashion design circle. Can you tell us what were some of the celebrities that you're familiar with?
Oh, I designed a lot for the movie star because they was in Hong Kong. A lot of movie stars come to Hong Kong make a movie, you know. And a lot of tourists, they come, a lot of society lady, a lot of rich society lady, American society lady come to Hong Kong as a tourist. And they live in the hotel. So they came to my fashion salon and they want me to design something for them. And I did. So I did like a Miss America. She didn't pay me because she's a young girl, you know. But I like her. I gave her a couple of things that I designed. She's, you know. And then I have a big movie star, like William Holden. And he came with his wife and he had to make the movie. So he tell me to entertain his wife. How can I entertain his wife? I just make all the clothes for her, for Mrs. William Holden. That's what I did.
That's an amazing story that you were able to kind of...
Many movies that come to Hong Kong make movies.
Yeah.
And they come with a wife, and I have to entertain the wife.
Mm-hmm.
And then I make things for them. I don't make men's clothes. I just only make women's clothes.
Mm-hmm. I'm amazed also how you connect with them. Like
they just walk into my salon.
Oh, wow.
Because it's open every day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you have one salon or do you have multiple salons?
No, only one salon in the Hilton Hotel.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have a factory. If somebody like Neiman Marcus, they want to buy something from, they have to come to the factory. That's for the export line,
mm-hmm.
not for the local, for the export.
Yeah,
I'm the only owner, and I do work like 12 hours a day. I kill myself to work because so many things have to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are a lot of movie stars in my car, like Shirley, MacLaine, also my customer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Financially, I'm also curious. Like,
I saved the money. I told you from the mail order that started,
mm-hmm.
and then the mail order business is doing very, very well. And I save the money to open the store. And the store makes money. Then I don't spend the money. I save the money to make the factory.
Mm-hmm.
So I started from nothing. And develop in the 10 years, getting bigger and bigger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I cannot get a good job from anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's how funny it is.
Yeah. I remember you told me you initially moved to Hong Kong, you were only allowed something like 20 yuan. Your pocket and
I like to go to Hong Kong, take a lot of money, leave China. Yeah, you don't allow. So then I don't have money in Hong Kong. So that's what I have to work. When I get to Hong Kong, I have to get a job.
Mm.
Right away, even I don't know how to do the job, I have to get a job.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
did you decide to move to the U.S.?
Oh, no, that's a different story. I don't want to move to the United States. I came here to do fashion show, and I came since 1964. I come to America every year to do fashion show. So until 1975, almost 10 years every year I come to America. And I have a good time every time I come to America. A lot of department store entertaining me, a lot of good parties I attend. Sometimes I go to visit all the museums, and I have a good time. I never think I want to live in America. No, I never think about it. But the one time, I was working very hard in New York to prepare a fashion show, another fashion show. And I fainted, you know, in the office. And they delivered to me to the hospital, and the doctor said, "My God, young lady, you are too underweight. Your blood is not enough blood, and you're very weak. I don't think you can continue to work until you relax for 2 or 3 years until you recover. Maybe you can continue to work. Not right now. So what can I do? This work every day I have to do work. So finally I think to myself, either I want my health back or I have to continue my business. Because I'm the one person running the whole business. I don't have anybody really help me. No. So I don't have partner. I don't have anybody really help me. So I was figuring, I think I have enough the fashion business. Not only my health is going down, also the fashion change. Everybody want me to design sportswear, and including blue jean. Mm-hmm. And I have no idea. I never play sports myself. I don't know what a sportswear looks like. So I try to make a little sportswear at line, at another line, and nobody likes it. They think it's not fun enough. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not really sportswear. It's still too classic looking, you know what I mean? Yeah. Too formal looking. Mm-hmm. So I know I cannot design sportswear. The profession changed. The women wear pants, the women wear blue jean. They don't wear cocked dress every day, mm-hmm. you know? So I said, this is the time I should retire, because mm-hmm. I don't know how to do the sportswear. And I failed. You know, the last fashion show, I didn't do very well. The comments are not that good like the before, you know. Mm-hmm. So then I have to relax, and the doctor says, you stay in America, the doctor is the best doctor. You know, Hong Kong doesn't have the kind of good doctor. So that's why in a way, I don't even think I would live in America. I stuck in America. That's where it is, for 2 or 3 years, the beginning. Yeah. Then afterwards, I don't have anything in Hong Kong anymore because I closed the factory. And I don't have any business, so I just live in America afterwards. Mm-hmm. And I like art. Then I go to study art and do CC Wong. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And but that time I cannot buy anything because I don't know anything. You know. So CC Wong teaching me, he don't teach me how to paint because I don't want to be a painter. He teach me how to recognize good art and how you buy the art in the auction. He teach me those things. So that's why I always go to Sotheby Christie. I don't know what I buy, but I like what I buy, that's all.
Yeah.
So that's the whole story. Then I started my art collecting.
Then how did you meet Sissy Wong?
Oh, he's my father's friend. Yeah.
So your father is also, did he cook?
No, my father also, they have the same teacher, Wu Fan.
Oh.
Yeah, my father also under Wu Fan, and Sissy Wong also under Wu Fan. So they don't close each other very much like a friend because my father is older than CC Wong. But
come and eat.
But they know each other.
Okay.
But they know each other. Mm-hmm. So I go to CC Wong and right away he accepted me.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
And what kind of classes did you take from CC
Wong? No, he had no class. He just one by one. Whatever I don't understand, he teach me. No, there's no class.
Do you remember the first piece of collection you
had? Oh yes, that's a very interesting story. Mm. Of course, Sissy buys the famous artist, you know, Yuan and Song Dynasty, you know, that's Sissy's collection. You know. And I cannot buy because first of all, too expensive. And then if he wants to buy, I cannot buy against him. You understand what I mean? So then, I don't know what I buy. So one time, I have a girlfriend. She works in the Washington, a small auction house called Salon, S-L-O-A-N-E. And she's a good girl, and she's my girlfriend. And she doesn't understand paintings. and Chinese painting, but she knows work of art, you know, Chinese art, I mean object, you know. So we become a good friend, and then she's telling me, she said, Dora, we have some painting, maybe not correct, maybe it's not real, you know, maybe it's attributed to, you know. But if it's cheap, you buy, because it's too expensive, I don't have the kind of money to buy. And so I look at, and I think it's very good, I like to buy. And then her boss tell me, Dora, don't buy. I said, why? He says, this piece is to show in the one museum, you know, the Freer Art, F-R-E-R, in Washington, D.C., because the owner died, and the wife want to give this whole painting collection to the museum, and the museum don't think it's real, so they don't want it. So that's what the wife bring to the auction house to sell. He says, if you want to buy real good things, don't buy those things. It may be not real, you know, because the museum doesn't want it, you know. Her boss told me not to buy. I said, I don't care.
Come and eat.
Okay, so then he told me not to buy, and I studied again, and I think the price cheap, so I bought the whole collection. And then you know why? From this collection, I showed to Sotheby's and Christie. Everybody says, every piece is real, not fake, not attributed to. And I made a lot of money from this collection. I have the money to buy better things. That's what I started my art. And I have confidence myself, because everybody said not real, and I look at it's real. I bought it, become real. And I think it's real. So I recognize my eyes is good. I don't have knowledge, actually. We'll do next time, okay?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much, Dora. Can you talk about how you started collecting?
Because I always like art, mm-hmm. painting, object, even when I was a little girl. And my father used to collect paintings. He very interesting Chinese old paintings. So we, in our whole house, we hung a lot of old paintings, and I help him to take care of it. You know, but I don't understand, you know. So I just love to look at them, you know. So I have the traditional interest because my father interested in Chinese painting. Mm-hmm. So when I met C.C. Wong, and he of course he's the expert of the Chinese old paintings. And he tell me how good they are, and how rare they are, how treasures they are. Mm-hmm. And so I begin very interesting. Of course, some of the old painting, the real good one, the masterpiece in the auction, I can afford to buy. They're very, very expensive. So I told you the story. I started to bought a collection painting, which is an American gentleman has it. And the museum doesn't want it, and I bought from the auction. And they think it's a fake, and I bought it, and CC1 says, fantastic, it's all real. Mm-hmm. And I made a lot of money, and that makes me have a confidence to continue to buy. Mm-hmm. Maybe I have a good eye, but I don't have knowledge at that time, so I still have to learn it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And what steps did you take to learn that skills in training your eyes?
No, my eye, because I was in the fashion business, so art and fashion, they all beautiful things. So you know, I can close to, I cannot learn any other things, in other words. But to learn art is very quickly, I can absorb the feelings and everything.
Did you have a strategy when building your collection?
Not really, because mm-hmm. it's opportunity. If I cannot get a lot of good pieces, the collection doesn't mean anything. So I'm just looking very hard all over the world. Some is in the auction in the Paris, in London, in Sweden, even in Japan. I pay attention to what they have. So a lot of times, if I have the opportunity, I can get a little cheaper. I bought, you know, from all over the world. It depends on the opportunity how I can get it.
You mentioned that you source your works from auction houses. Can you talk about how you started getting familiar of yourself with the auction business, your relationship with the auction business?
I interested in to go to the auction because you never know. Every time you go, you hope you can get it, you know. It's not like you go to department store, you can always buy, you know. So auction house is depends on how many people bidding it. Mm-hmm. So if I lucky, then I can get it, you know. So that's what I'm very interested in auction, you know. I'm not interested in go to antique shop, just buy what they say, you know. And then if I don't understand, the major auction house like Sotheby Christie, they all have experts, and they're very nice. They can teach me a little bit, and they tell me this you don't have to buy. Maybe not that good. This one's very good. You can buy. You know, they can teach me a little bit before I buy it.
Yeah, I was fascinated with the anecdote that you told me about your dog in the auction house. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I see. I love animals, and this dog actually is a gift for me from my friend, and because his eyes are not very good, you know, so it's like by nature. I mean, he's born the eyes is very not too clear to look at things. So I always holding him when I go out because he cannot walk very good by himself. So I holding him in the auction room, and one time, I don't know, all of a sudden he raises a hand. So the auctioneer said, "Are you bidding?" You know, he says, "I take your bid." That's how interesting it is. Of course, I wave my hand. I said, no, he cannot buy. So everybody knows this dog, you know, he's very famous in the auction house because every time I don't want to leave him home and I love him and he cannot walk around too much, so he's very well behaved, you know, so I can always hold him, holding him.
Yeah.
He's a Shih Tzu. The dog's, the breed is Shih Tzu, very pretty, you know, very small, tiny dog, you know.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the dogs you had? I remember you told me that there were like six or seven of them that you had.
Oh, no, I never buy a dog, but usually because I love animals and I can take care of them because I have time. You know? So a lot of my friends, and they knew that I love dogs and I have time to take care of them because I don't have a real job, you know, to go out. So when the dog get old, they need somebody special taking care of him or her. So they give to me the older dog, which they don't have the time to take care of them. Mm-hmm. So I happen to have two or three other, afterwards I have, since this dog died, and I have two or three older dogs, senior dog, and I take care of them, you know, until they die.
Can you tell us a little bit about some of the highlights of your collection?
I mainly collected Ronald Horn cups, which is antique, and mostly it's from 14th century to 18th century, and it's made of Asian rhinoceros, not the African one. They are very, very good, and they're good carving that time. Usually in the old days, those rhinoceros are very expensive, the horn. So they made specially, the artist is a very, very good artist, and they carved for especially for the king, you know, or maybe big officers, you know, but ordinary people cannot afford to have it, you know. So this thing is very, very rare, and it's only like the best piece is only like 200 pieces in the whole world they make. Of course, they make 1,000, 2,000 altogether, but the good ones only less than 200, and most of them in the museum. And so that's what I think it's a very, very good things to collect. And CC1 agreed that he said you should collect that. And it's all real. You don't have to ask me if it's fake and real, you know. And sometimes the price is very high. I cannot afford it. But sometimes, you know, it depends on if I'm lucky, I get one very good ones. And each one is only one piece. You never find the two pieces look the same. Never. The artist only carved the one piece and put the name on the cup and give to the very high officer or the king, you know. So I feel if a painting, there's a many painting, one artist can paint 2,000 pieces. This kind of carving, an artist only make one of each kind, you know. So to me it's very, very precious to me, you know. So I collect almost 30-40 very good pieces, my collection. And unfortunately right now the wildlife department, they don't understand this kind of antique cups. They think it's made in same thing with the African horn. They don't want people to kill the rhino in the African, But the African horn's no good. they can make it an object, but not as good looking as the Asian horn. And the Asian rhinoceros horn, it's extinct, no more. Even the 18th century is very little left. So they don't understand the difference. So in the law, right now the law cannot sell because they don't know. They just think maybe you sell that, people will kill more rhino. Actually, the rhinos in Africa is an entirely different species.
Mm.
Yeah. And then my another collection is the court painting, because I cannot buy the real masterwork like Wen Zhengming, Wang Yunqi, this kind of famous Song Dynasty, Ming Dynasty masterwork, because it costs a lot of money. And besides, my teacher want to buy. I cannot against him, you know.
Mm.
Yeah. And so I collect the court painting, which is very good artist to paint it. They're usually a court painter. Paint for the king and the royalty family. But they're not allowed to sign their name on the painting. So people think it's just like an ancestor portrait. They think it's nothing, you know. Actually, it's a very important painting, so I can have an opportunity to buy a little cheaper than this way, you know. So I have very good core painting, mostly the portrait of the royal family, like the king's brother, king's son, you know. I have a very good portrait painting, yeah. Including the Bannerman painting, which I have four very good Bannerman painting. They're only one of each kind, so I have it, other people don't have it. So that's why all the museum interesting, to display for them and display them, and also they want me someday I can give to them or sell to them, whatever it is. Yeah.
Can we also talk about the chair that you're sitting on, which is the
this is I like antique things, so I like antique furniture also. Those furniture made in the wood called Wanfali wood, which the wood is extinct also.
Mm-hmm.
Usually they grow in Hainan Dao and in the very hot tropical weather, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But they grow every year very little bit. So since in the Ming Dynasty, everybody likes this kind of wood, and they cut off all the trees, so the extinct, the trees extinct. You have to wait for another couple hundred years to grow back again, because every year they grow very little, you know. And so this kind of furniture become very rare and very, very expensive. So I fortunately, in the 80s and 90s, I bought some pieces.
Mm-hmm.
I use them myself, not for investment and not for any other reason. Because I think to buy modern furniture, you use it, it doesn't worth any money. This kind of furniture, every year they grow more varied. You know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I like it. I like the look, they're beautiful. They're like a golden color, you know, golden
mm-hmm.
yellow color. And it's, the wood is very refined, you know. And the workmanship is, of course, is good, because the wood is so expensive, they cannot have the cheap workmanship, you know. So I just love them, you know, to use it, you know, in my home.
Yeah.
Mm.
Well, can you also talk about your motivation for collecting? I'm sure besides the emotional and the financial benefit, you had this connection with, as you said, time and history. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
What mean the history?
Like the motivation for collecting, like when you see a piece of work that is from many, many years ago that is so delicate and ornamental.
Well, I just have the feeling and the emotional patience, you know, to love them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think about really, the time I bought it, I don't know how much they will go price. I don't know. I just love them, and I can afford to buy, I just buy, you know. But of course, you have to have a little good collection people enjoy to, you know, look at. You cannot just have one piece. That's what accumulated, the same thing. I don't want to buy any other type of stuff, because I want to make a very good collection. And all the museum interesting, they display for me already. All my things is already displayed in the Hong Kong Museum, in the Washington DC Free Art Museum,
mm-hmm.
and Peabody Museum,
mm-hmm.
and China Institute, you know, many different museums in the whole world, you know. So they know my collection. A lot of museums knew my collection and they love it. Yeah, especially Washington DC, a free art museum. They said, Dora, you have to leave something to us in the future. And I promise them I will.
That's amazing that you are contributing your art for the public pleasure as well as your own. And I'm also amazed that you've always been very supportive of the younger Chinese art, contemporary artists. Can you talk about some of the anecdotes and how you met these artists and how you support them?
I really don't understand contemporary art. Sometimes I think a little bit too wild, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not like the classical Chinese painting is very, very calm, you know, very soothing, you know. In the contemporary art, sometimes I get shocked with my eyes, you know. And I couldn't say they're good or bad because I'm really not an expert to talk like that. But I encourage people, especially the younger artists, encourage them to paint better. And if I can help them, if they want to have a showing in a museum or maybe trying to sell one or two pieces in auction, if I know any connection, social connection, I will introduce to them, I will help them. Mm-hmm. But I'm not an expert on contemporary myself.
Thank you for sharing, and I'm amazed how modest you are, like giving how much you've done for the younger artists. And if you were to share some advice for the younger generations of collectors or aspired collectors, what would you tell them?
Well, I think you have to work harder every day, you know. Mm-hmm. You cannot just think about you'll be famous in one day or you can sell millions of dollars right away. I say you have to continue to work hard to look at more other people's work and to learn more, and then one day, eventually, you will be very successful.
Mm. Well, thank you so much for sharing. Mm-hmm. And next, I'm also wondering how your identity as an Asian American or Chinese American in the art scene in New York has impacted your kind of establishment as a collector.
I just try to do the best I can do here. But I cannot compare with a lot of big collectors because they're usually a big industry businessman. Mm-hmm. They can buy anything they want, you know. But I think even my collection is not a big quantity. I think it's very unique and it's very meaningful, not only to me, to the even next generation. Mm-hmm. Because they cannot find this kind of thing anymore.
Yeah.
They cannot find the Asian Renaissance carving anymore. They cannot find the court painting anymore.
Mm.
They can find any other art, but they cannot find this kind of art.
Yeah. And I'm also curious, since you came to the U.S. by yourself, and as an Asian woman, and in a very kind of male-dominated art scene in New York, like, have you felt that like you had to work and, like...
I had to work harder.
Yes.
Really, I had to work harder.
Mm-hmm.
And I only buy the thing they don't pay attention, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like the core painting, most people, if they're not so understand history and everything, they think the kind of painting don't even ask the name. Because they buy the name.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a Wen Zemin, they will buy. If it's not Wen Zemin, they don't buy. So the core painting has no ask the name. They just think no good. So that's why they don't pay attention to it.
And I also want to pivot into your connection with Texas, since you went on a number of roadshows and you worked with department stores. In your fashion design.
I went to Texas because the Neiman Marcus is one of my my clients, you know, and Mr. Stanley Marcus, very interesting, my creation, you know, in the clothing business. And so he invited me every time, every year he invited me to go there, have a show in their store.
Mm-hmm.
And then he invited a lot of people, a lot of his customers, to try my things and to sell to the local, mostly society lady and very rich woman in Texas. You know.
Yeah.
So they help them to get more business and help me more famous in America. I have a very good relationship with Mr. Stanley Marcus and his brother, Lawrence Marcus.
And in your own like fashion like in your own closet, what kind of fashion do you like to adorn yourself with?
You mean what I wear myself?
Yes.
Well, I'm a petite person, so I can buy other designers' clothes very cheap because they cannot sell the petite size easily. And most American ladies are very tall and very big, so I can get cheaper that way. I will buy sometimes famous American designers' things. Yeah, but mostly I wear my own design because I have my tailors, I have my workers. They can make for me very cheap in my own workshop. And so I wear my own clothes, and my own design a lot of times. Sometimes I buy other designers' clothes. Sometimes other designer likes me, they give me the sample so I can wear.
That's amazing. And were you like one of the very few Asian fashion designers back then in New York? In the, I guess it's the 1960s, right? 60s and 70s.
I started in 1960, yeah, but I worked almost 15 years in the fashion world.
Yeah.
In Hong Kong,
Were you one of the few Asian female?
No, not so many people do the same. Like they just have a store in Hong Kong. They don't go outside. They don't go America, go to England. No. Only me, I go every year.
Yeah.
Go other country. Yeah. Mm.
Were there any point in time during your career or your collecting kind of life, were you kind of racially discriminated against? Do you feel that?
No, just on the opposite. They're all amazing that being a Chinese woman can do that kind of work, because a lot of American lady can do a lot of things. The Chinese lady usually just be housewife or stay home, you know. So they're very amazing. Everybody say, how can you do that? How can you do that? I say, well, I've just tried my best, you know. And so I get more attention and more admire from American people, you know, like that. Because very, very unique, you know, somebody like me come to America, a woman, you know, a Chinese woman.
Yeah, you must be very, very proud of yourself.
No, yeah. I don't. I don't know. I just try my best, that's all.
Yeah. And I remember you told me that you worked so hard during your early life in your 30s that you kind of burn out a little bit in your physical health. Can you like tell us like what drove you to work so hard back then?
Well, I have to because I have a big responsibility. I have 300 people depend on their living on me. My workers, I have to pay them every week, you know. So if I don't work hard, I don't get enough orders from the customers. I have no money to pay them. And you know, so that's what I have big responsibility. I need a lot of customer orders to keep them busy, in other words, because I pay them by pieces. If they work 10 pieces a day, they get how much money? If they make 15 pieces, they get more money. So I have to get a lot of orders from the different customers, you know. So that's what I have to work hard. I have responsibility, you know, not for me, my own thing. If I'm my own thing, I don't have to work that hard. If I'm just designer for some company, then I don't have to work that hard because I have to support all those workers. So I have to get enough quantity to pay them, you know, to let them work busy every day.
That's fascinating.
我无所谓，八条六条都可以。我不知道他们库房里头有多少，我不知道。哎，红的多一点，当然红的多一点。